Welcome to the second Sunday of the year.
And since you're here, that means you're ready for not only some worship, but some church announcements too. Woo! Here they come. This Wednesday, it's middle of the month, and that means the mid-month meal is here. Better get hungry for it.
We're going to have some Frito pies, some nachos, and some chili. You can have a combination of everything if you want. It's up to you.
And so you want to come, you want to bring your family, it's $5 for one person or $15 for three or more family members.
Don't miss out on this opportunity to have some good fellowship and good food here at the church. It's from 5:15 to 6:15.
So come and get some.
This Wednesday is also going to be our business meeting, and what we're going to be doing is approving the ministry teams. So if you haven't turned in your list of ministry teams,
or your changes that are on your ministry team, get it done, because this Wednesday we're voting, come a dry creek or high water. Might I come up with that? Starting in just a few weeks on February 1st at 6:30, it's a ministry called Grief Share. Melissa Neiman has been the point person on this. You don't have to have just lost a family member. You might be having a difficult time or a season that you're going through. It's just tough to deal with. You'll want to be part of this ministry. You can contact Melissa Neiman at 777-1962, or she might even be in church right here to go over there and ask her about it. February 1st, 6:30, Grief Share.
You may be noticing real soon that we're going to be having some new security measures here at Calvary. Steve, why don't you tell us about those?
Those new security measures are going to be some magnetic door locks right outside the church office and over by the kitchen door. You'll be able to be buzzed in because we can't do church like we used to do church. So we're beefing up our security. To come and yank on the door, give Carol a second to buzz you in, but this is the way we're going. That's all your announcements for this Sunday morning. That means worship's coming.
Right, hope you're ready for it. Let's worship.
That's real calm, John. Hey, we're doing worship!
He forced me to do that. Why don't you stand and greet one another this morning? Yeah. seat.
Woohoo! Have a seat. Let me get ready here. Okay. This is to remind me not to forget that we're starting Operation Christmas Child today. It's almost there. We've got a tub outside. Okay, I'll take it off. My hair will mess up, but... Joanne Harrington and her husband Kevin went over to Dallas last December for Operation Christmas Child, and it was amazing to them. We did it. We collected and put together 204 boxes, but they are more passionate about that. They're going to be distributors and want Calvary to be a drop-off point. So she is starting collecting goods. For January, it's gloves, hats, and scarves. This is like $3 for two pair and a dollar for a hat. But we've got a tub out there, and we'd like to have two or three tubs over the next few weeks filled up. And throughout the year, we're going to be collecting, and then in October, starting to put together, we're hoping 300 shoeboxes, and other places will come here to drop off their stuff. We'll ship them out over to Dallas. So it's a pretty big thing. If you want to be part of Operation Christmas Child, starting now, Joanne Harrington would love your help. But there's a tub out there, and I'm going to throw these back in there. Don't forget, church office will be closed tomorrow for MLK holiday. The deacons of the week, Jamie Humphreys and Greg Crutcher, are in here. Their numbers are here. If something comes up and you need a staff member, please contact one of the deacons. But we will be closed for the holiday tomorrow. Lots going on. I think a cold front's coming. Well, dress warmly this week. It's going to be cool out there. Winds are blowing tomorrow. Lots going on. Don't forget, Wednesday's great meal to warm you up. Chili, Frito pie, nachos, come enjoy the fellowship. It'll be a great time. One of the other ways we warm up, especially on Sunday, and that's through prayer. We love to pray here at Calvary, and we invite you to pray because we profess the family of God comes here. That means nobody's alone. So Kim and I are going to be down here. You're welcome to walk right on down here and join us for prayer. You're welcome to sit right where you're at, but you don't sit alone here at Calvary. You're part of a family. So let's reach out to one another and go before the Lord right now in prayer.
Thanking you for another Lord's Day and just an opportunity to come and worship you. And we just pray as we begin our worship this morning that you prepare our hearts, that it can truly be a time of worshiping you. We thank you for the praise band and them leading out in preparing our worship. And we pray for Brother Steve as he brings the word to us. And we just pray that we would hear what you have for us today. We thank you for this church and the many ways you've blessed it. And we thank you for the good spirit that we have here. We pray that you forgive us of the many times we fail you. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen. We're going to invite you to worship this morning. However you do that, it's up to you. If you want to stand up, you can. If you want to stay sitting, if you want to close your eyes, if you want to raise your hands, that's all on you. You worship how you need to.
church. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. God, come thou fount of every blessing. Tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing. Pour songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung thy flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it. Mount of thy redeeming love. Come thou fount, come thou King. Come thou precious Prince of Peace. Hear your bride to you we sing. Come thou fount of our blessing.
I was lost in utter darkness until he came and he rescued me. That's true for you too, church.
I was lost in utter darkness till you came and rescued me. I was bound to all my sin when your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing anew. Now my heart has found a home. Now your grace is always with me, and I'll never be alone.
Amen.
Come thou fount, come thou King. Come thou precious Prince of Peace. Hear your bride.
To grace, how great a debtor. Sing it with your heart this morning.
And oh, to grace, how great a debtor. Daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wonder, Lord, I feel. To leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
We're going to sing that again, but I want you to know what you're singing about. It says, prone to wonder, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. As humans, we naturally want to roam away from God and His love. Whenever something happens and something comes up in life, that's the first thing we do is run away. When really we should be running toward God. And so rather than that, that's what we're singing about. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. So let's sing that again. Prone to wonder.
Prone to wonder, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord. Take and seal it for thy courts above. Come thou fount, come thou King. Come thou precious Prince of Peace. Hear your cry, to you we sing.
hope it's true that you love Jesus. That's what this song is called, Jesus, We Love You.
To you our hearts will cry, to you we lift on high. You chose to stand and fight, and so we give our lives. You were the sacrifice, you came and paid the price. You gave us back our sight, and there is no more night.
We're going to sing that again. I want you to think about the words. I want you to mean them from your heart.
To you our hearts will cry, to you we lift on high. You chose to stand and fight, and so we give our lives. You were the sacrifice, you came and paid the price. You gave us back our sight, and there is no more night. Just we bow down before you, we worship and adore you. And you're worthy of all praise. Jesus, you are holy. We bring you praise and glory. And I will love you all my days. We will love you.
You are the King of Kings.
You are the King of Kings. Protect me under your wings. To you this offering I bring, my life, my everything. May I always believe you know what's best for me. And Lord, you help me to see that I have been set free. 'Cause we bow down before you, we worship and adore you. You're worthy of all praise. Jesus, you are holy. We bring you praise and glory. And I will love you all my days. We will love you.
Thank you for your breath.
For your breath, thank you for your time, thank you for your death, thank you for your life. There's so much to say, there's so much we can do. May everything we are be glorifying you. There's no giving up, there's no giving in. Fill up my cup, you took away my sin. There is no one else who loves me like you do. And so we lift you up, Jesus, we love you. We bow down before you, we worship and adore you. And you're worthy of all praise.
Do you believe in Him? That's what this song's about.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating One, God Almighty. Through Your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus.
If you believe it, church, I want you to sing with your heart this morning. Our judge and our defender.
Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Oh, I believe in the name.
I believe.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe. Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Oh, I believe in the name.
Father, we believe in you this morning. I don't know what the hearts out there are going through. I know what my heart's going through. So, Father, I pray that you would help us to believe you. I pray that you would help us to trust you above anything else this world offers, what this world tells us. Speak to us this morning, God. Be with us as a church body, as a church family. Help us to do your will, what you want us to do. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Good to have you here this morning. I hope you engaged in worship and didn't let it pass you by. Now, last week we started a new series, The Word Family. And I had a picture up there last week that, guess it didn't connect with you and your family. Had a couple of siblings fighting in the background, mom giving dad the look, and so evidently that's not your... So I found the picture probably represents your family. The perfect family, right? Just go ahead and say that's me. That's me, my wife, my kids, my husband, that's us. Yeah. I know it's tough to admit, but there really isn't the perfect family out there. You want them. You want those kids to be perfect, don't you, parents? and you have trained them, you have talked to them, you've read stories to them about how easy it is to be perfect. Somehow or another, they got off the beaten path. Growing up, I know it's very, very hard to believe, but this guy right here got into the muck growing up. I was a muck finder, and I found it every time I went looking for it. When I left on a Saturday night to go out with the guys or go out cruising Maine, how many of y'all remember cruising? Usually we had to cruise looking for some kind of trouble out there, and I found it real easy, and I would get in the muck. And I know Mom and Dad, when I walked out the door, their eyes went in the back of their head like, "Dear God, please, just bring him back with nothing broken." Because I was into it. I was a muck finder. Muck and mire was my middle name. I was in it. And I got into it real quick, real deep, and it was hard for me to get out because I'm not going to blame my friends. I'm just going to blame my raising. I'm just going to blame that was the choices that I made when I grew up. And I know you like to look at your life, that perfect life that you live, that perfect words that you speak to your perfect family. But we're going to talk a little bit more about not so perfect, because there ain't none. I mean, you think about some characters. We started with Adam and Eve last week, and you know, what happened to their boys, Cain and Abel? Wow, Cain didn't like what Abel did, so went out and murdered his baby brother, and it was on from then on. There's some people in the Bible that you might not even put together with, but there, like I said, Adam and Eve, there's Abraham, lied about his wife. I just had so many down here. Jacob was a deceiver. Rachel was a kleptomaniac. Moses had a little bit of a temper. Samson, though he was strong and powerful, had a little thing with weakness towards the women. Noah had a little problem with the, that fermented juice. Yeah, had a little, and then for some reason when he got that fermented juice in him, his clothes got real heavy, so they somehow kept on falling off. And so that was in his family. You're like, "Hey man, you're talking about Uncle Bob." I tell you, when Uncle Bob comes over, and I say that, we've all got Uncle Bob or Aunt Sue in the family. And we all just roll our heads in the back, our eyes in the back of the head going, "Oh, not this reunion, please." So there ain't no perfect families. When we get that wrapped around our heads, we've got to make a decision. We're going to acknowledge this. Hey, we're not perfect, but we're walking in the steps of perfection. So we're trying to get there, or we're just going to run amok. And running amok is something, is what dads like to do when they teach their kids things. Come on, Dad, help her out. Spray the car.
Adelaide, spray the car.
Maybe we'll teach our kid how to kick the ball. Way to go, Dad. We're all about teaching our family things. And we get our family together, and then somehow the teaching turns. And maybe you're that person in your family that turned from the perfect, pristine white sheep to the black sheep. Maybe every time your name was mentioned, somebody spit on the ground and said, "Oh, there's trouble. I don't see how those parents made it through those teenage years with Steve." Well, bless them. So we think about those decisions that we make, and some of them are simple decisions. Get up, you're going to school. That's pretty simple. Or those trainings that we give our kids. Make your bed, pick up your clothes, take out the trash. And when those things, those covenants, those laws, those house, anybody have house rules? When you were growing up, house rules? You guys are a run amuckers then. Nobody had house rules over here. Jeez, you probably got breakfast in bed from Mom and Dad. We had house rules, and when the house rules were broken, I got the adjustment. You know, and that adjustment came out quick and swift, and let's try it again, son. And so when I tried it again, I got it right. I got my clothes up off the floor. I put them not near the hamper, but in the hamper. Did anybody have chores? I know it's an old, old stoic word. Anybody have to work around the house? And what happened when you didn't work around the house? What happened when you broke, like, curfew? I didn't really understand curfew because I never came in on time, but my dad reminded me the next morning, "Stephen, Evidently, you got plenty of energy to stay out all night, so it's time to get up. And he'd give me them old rusty hand shears. And out in the backyard were some bushes, some hedges, and off for a couple few hours trimming the hedges. You got plenty of energy to stay out all night. You got plenty of energy to work around the house. It's hard to argue when you break the covenants or the rules because there's consequences. So as we kick off, the front of your bulletin there has this. And this is one of those simple things, but for some reason we make it complex. And right here, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve. Whether, here's the first choice, gods of your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you were living. But, as for me and my household. Now, the one translation says my house. It's not talking about brick, mortar, glass, doors, and windows. Put a cross out there, my house is serving. No, it's talking about household, what the house is holding inside of it, which is you. As for me, my household, we will serve the Lord. So you've made a covenant right then. And maybe you're saying, well, Steve, I am the household. Me, well, praise God. Then you need to make a conscious decision. You're either going to follow the world or you're going to follow the creator of the world. That's what this scripture is saying. Either I'm going to be the head of the household, and in this household, we're going to follow and serve the Lord, or we're not. We're just not going to be Sunday followers and Monday muckers. We're going to follow God not just on Sunday, but come Monday when it's, oh, God, get the kids up. Just get the herd moving and all the clothes and the laundry and, oh, I'm out of gas. Oh, my gosh. We're still going to follow and serve the Lord because we're going to start breakfast with a prayer. Everybody gets a hug and a kiss, and I'm praying for you. But you might be saying, Steve, you don't know my household. You don't know my dad or my mom. You don't know my brother or my sister. They reign pure you-know-what in the household. Let me tell you, as much as there's a God in heaven, there's a devil in hell. And what this scripture verse is saying, either you're going to serve the God in heaven or you're going to serve the devil in hell. Because when you serve the God in heaven, you're going to really, really upset the devil in hell. And he will come after that family. And if he can't come after you as making the decision, as for me and my household, he'll come against somebody in that household who's connected to you. Amen? He'll come to somebody in that household who's connected to you. You might have armored up, fully armored up. You might have a child. You might have a spouse, you might have an in-law, you might have a friend, a distant relative who wants to come in that household and reign pure hell inside that household that said, we're serving the Lord. We're serving the Lord. So if you can't bring that worldly stuff in here, you can't bring that muck and mire into my house, we're not, or as we say, we're against it. We're not for it. It's not going to happen in here. In your household, you can do, say whatever you want, but in my household, this is what reigns. You don't run amok in my household. That's the rules. That's the covenant. And that's what this scripture verse is saying. You're going to need to make a decision today. If you're a household of one, you need to make a decision. As for me, I'm serving the Lord in this house. As for my household, if you're a family, then you make that commitment, that covenant. Because we're going to get around in the Old Testament, Jeremiah, about what happens when we break that covenant. And so many times we break that covenant. I know the message of family is touchy because I don't walk in your family and you don't walk in mine. So the only thing I have to go off is my family. A very dysfunctional family. A very broken. I come from a divorced family. And I know what it means to have parents just kind of put on the show, as you know. They were just held on to the kids. Well, the kid was the baby Steve here. Until big brother, big sister, and then baby Steve got out of the house, they held it together. But the harshest words ever spoken to me were from my dad. He said, I just stuck it out until you graduated. Jeez, that hurt. As soon as I graduated, man, boom, they were divorced and gone. That's tough to live in a divided household. Absolutely, that's what that scripture verse says. And that's what we're going to get to even in the next one here, when we come together as the perfect family in Mark 3. And it says it very clearly. So Jesus called them over to speak to them, began to speak to them in a parable, to tell a story. Can Satan drive out Satan? No, we know that. If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand, but here it is personally. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. A house divided cannot stand. Do you have a disagreement in your family? Absolutely. You want to bring up politics? That's what we talked about last week. More families seem to fight over politics than anything. Then it's money, then it's discipline, then it's whatever. But politics, golly gee, I bet you in here, if I had a political sermon series, we'd have a ruckus. There'd be some division in here. It's great to have differences of opinion, sure. But when it comes down to it, we're not divided. We are united in one cause. We are the family of God. Though we come from many families in here, if you stand under the banner that says Christian, you're under the banner of the Christian family. You might have a different denomination, but the religion that you're under is Christianity. We even sing about, I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Sometimes that might not be so legit, because sometimes we argue. We might have a little disagreements. I always tell the ladies when they have a fellowship out there, food, I said, so hamburgers? That's the number one meal in my hamburger. I said, you guys fix the hamburger? No, we're having, well, those things you don't like, Steve. We're having tuna fish casserole, tuna fish salad, tuna fish dessert, tuna fish shake. And so I have a disagreement with that. As long as I said, you have some bread, you got bread and water, at least I won't die today. So we have disagreements, and every, just like this Wednesday, we're having a fellowship chili. Now, could it be turkey chili, bison chili, wolf brand chili? I don't know. And they go, Steve, what would you eat? I'm like, hamburger. Just bring a hamburger. I'll be happy. So we do have disagreements, but when it comes down to it, when the bottom line, when the rubber meets the road, when the family needs to get together and hold tight, we're the family of God. We come together as a family, and there are those reasons that sometimes I think we give up. It's because we give up on hope. I'm done. Maybe you're here this morning and somebody in your family gave up on you. But boy, that girl's hopeless. They're a lost cause. I know some of us have heard that. Some of us might have had it said to us. But thankfully, there's a Father in heaven that says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. You will always be in my family. Now, I might discipline you. Those he loves, he disciplines. And I never got a spanking that I didn't deserve. My dad never beat me within an inch of my life. But he spanked me within an inch of my life because I needed it. I got outside the covenant in which he put me under. Stephen, make your bed. Stephen, pick up your clothes in the dirty hamper. Stephen, take out the trash. And Lord knows if mom or dad ever spoke to me and I'm like, huh? I never hunned my parents because I got a vocabulary adjustment. It started at the backside and worked its way out to, I'm sorry, mom. And it was always, yes, ma'am. Thank God for my mom and dad disciplining me because they wanted the best from their children. They wanted the family. Now, that did my family take different paths? Absolutely. Could you slip us underneath the word dysfunctional? Yep. Because the word dis means to discard. But functional. We've got to learn how to function together and not discard one another. Dysfunctional, not being part of. When we're dysfunctional, not part of the family, you're dysfunctional. To discard that person. It's hard, and I know. I know some of you very personally. I know your family history. You know my family history. I do. I have a sister that's up on a road that I can never go down, and I still love her, and I still pray for her. But she's made choices that I cannot follow the road she's on. And you might have a child. You might be that child that has made a choice, that's making a choice right now that is hard for people to come after you and go, come back. But what they're saying is, I'm right here. I'll be right here. When you get your act together, when you straighten up, when you call me, I'm going to be there. We've got a ministry here called 2 a.m. means even at 2 a.m. I'm there for you. And it might be being put to test tonight, right now. It might be right now this moment you've got a family that's in the grip of Satan and he's wanting to steal and kill and destroy and put you under that dysfunctional and ain't never going to be able to function again. Thankfully, we serve a God that says, I'm not going to be divided. I'm going to stand underneath God and His banner and His direction and His guidance. I'm in Jeremiah today, in Jeremiah chapter 11. It's a great story. I'm just going to pick a few things out of it. But in Jeremiah 11, it talks about the covenant, the house rules have been broken. Just, has anybody ever broken a house rule? You guys are perfect then. There's just three of us that have ever broken the house rule. You don't ever talk back to mom and dad. You pick up your room. You take out the trash. You guys never, you must not understand what I'm talking about. You must be. But for those who are right here with me, I've broken the covenant, broken the rule. And this is what it says, the covenant is broken. So here we are in verse 20. If you want to get up there, it's a great story to read. But Jeremiah has been told by God, hey, go to the people, go to the family and proclaim my covenant to them. That if they abide in me and keep my covenant, I will bless them. Here's the house rules. Go tell them, Jeremiah. Go to Judah and in Jerusalem and tell them, proclaim it. And he did. And they didn't like it. Here it is in verse 20 and 22. But the Lord Almighty and Jeremiah started telling them, and they're after me. They're on me. They don't like what I'm saying. Who judge righteously and test the heart and mind, let me see your vengeance. Jeremiah saying, Lord, they're after me. I need you to take care of me, Dad. And we know the word Abba, which means father, and father translates to daddy. And I can see Jeremiah going, hey, Dad, family's after me. Could you help me out? And Jeremiah is proclaiming this by saying, let me see your vengeance on them. I want you to understand how important this is right here. What he's doing isn't something he wants to do. He's asking the father over the household to implement punishment on his family. Because they have broken the covenant. Oh, I dearly remember a time or two when Stephen came home late. And right after Stephen came home, there was the man in blue. Do you own that car out there, sir? Well, yeah. Were you driving it 15? No, my son was. Well, it was heard speeding. We didn't know where it was going to, but we just cruising through the neighborhood, and there it is. So we can't really ticket him because we didn't see him speeding, but, oh, that was the end of that. See, back then I was so old, we didn't have cell phones to take away. And back then we had cars that actually had keys that went in them to start them. You know what I'm talking about? And so when you hear your first name, it's written on your birth certificate, or at least for me, it meant trouble. You, I don't know. Stephen! There's a man here to see you. That officer is still there, and he let me know that I had broken the law, but he couldn't cite me a ticket. That would have been easy to the law broke underneath the Carter house. Because in the Carter house, you don't do that. You don't cause other people harm or danger when you're out there in the public. So Dad let me know that. Give me the car keys. And it was the typical, okay, here it comes, off with the belt. So I was 16, 17, still got spanked because I still broke the covenant, the law. And what is happening here is a man came to the Carter household and said, somebody in this household broke the law. And what are you going to do about it? So the man of the house, my dad said, I'll take care of this and take care of it. He did. And I was duly punished. Like I said, I was never spanked for not doing something that I didn't need to get spanked for. And so in our lives, we have to understand, choose this day whom you'll serve means you have to make a choice every single day. It didn't say choose this day for the rest of your life. Tomorrow morning when you get up, choose this day. Choose this day. When your kids get up and they're spinning around and they're screaming and yelling and crying, you know who got into them. And we have to tell them, hey guys, come here, let's regroup, let's refocus. It's going to be a better day today. Even our little angels that sit around us, that when we polish them up and make them picture perfect can still be little hellions, true? They still can be because they have an individual personality. That little angel today in church might be the you-know-what tomorrow. And you're like, where did you come? Hun, that's your child. It's your side of the family acting up. That my side doesn't do that. Well, again, it's the journey that we take. So Jeremiah is saying, Lord, the family is after me. Therefore, this is what the Lord says after his child Jeremiah comes to the people of Anatoth, who are threatening to kill you, saying, do not prophesy in the name of the Lord, or you will die by our hands. God said, Jeremiah, go give them the covenant. Jeremiah said, I got you, Lord. Got you, Daddy. I went to my brothers and sisters, and they said, shh, hush your lip, we're going to kill you. That's what they said. And so in your household right now, if you've ever compromised and let something come in that you knew was wrong, and all of a sudden you wanted to have that happen, you go back to letting something come in that the devil wanted you to have. There's a demon out there that wants to come in every single family and to steal and to kill and destroy. It might be last week with your feelings getting hurt, and then you start feuding with somebody, and then the fisticuffs start happening, and then there's a fatality. Somebody might have just said, I'm taking my teddy bear and I'm leaving. They might be packing their backpack. They might be grabbing the keys. You're like, hey, wait a minute. Kind of stop, say, that's my car. You want to hit that world and you want to go tear it up, you go after it, but you go foot free. Them clothes you got in that bag, I bought them. So whatever clothes you got on your back, knock yourself out. I've seen those kids. I've heard those kids. I can't wait to get out of this house. Anybody want to own up to that one? Oh, I can't wait to get out of here. I can live on my own. I know how this works. Then we get out there in that big, mean world. And it's big and it's mean. And it's hurtful and it's hateful. And what Jeremiah did was he went back to his dad. He said, Dad, they're hurting me. And Dad said, I'll take care of them. Don't prophesy. Don't bring that stuff around here, or you'll die by our hands. Therefore, this is what the Lord, this is what Dad says to the family. I'll punish them. Their young men will die by the sword, their sons and daughters by famine. Now, that's a punishment. That's a punishment. That's how serious God is about us keeping the covenant of the family together. You might be in a family right now going through some ruckus. Somebody might have stepped right off into the muck, and they're sinking. You're thinking, what are we going to do about this? How are we going to get out of this mess? In just one chapter over in Jeremiah 12, it says this, your brothers, comma, your own family, even they have betrayed you. They've raised a loud cry against you. It's okay to, I guess, be betrayed by somebody you don't know, but be betrayed by somebody in the family hurts. And again, the family of God, we unfortunately hurt each other because things just don't go our way. Steve went long. He didn't have the right. He's not under this. He moves around too much. He got off the stage and came out and looked at me. If our feelings are that much on our sleeve, then shouldn't we be under God's conviction and say, he needed to look at me real good too? Because I am in the family of God and I have caused it. I'm the muck maker. I'm exactly who he talked about. I'm the one that he should be looking at. Because I broke the covenant of the family. And God said, my children have broken my covenant, my family covenant, so punishment comes when we break the law. I'm wondering who you're serving today. It's Sunday, isn't it? Well, of course, I serve the Lord. I'm going to go out there and have a meal, and we're going to hold hands in public and say a dinner prayer. What are you going to do tomorrow? What are you going to do tomorrow when you're around that group that's saying some things that you know aren't right to say or want you to kind of give your two cents, kind of spew a little gossip in there, want you to spread it with them? Are you still going to be serving the Lord like you said today? As for me and my household goes with you wherever you go. When you leave today and you go back to your household, that's great, but where are you going tomorrow when you disperse? School, work, the community. You're still representing your household. That name that you have at the end goes with you. And when you break the covenant, That name is spoken in the community, is it not? Oh man, there's that Carter guy. One of the most embarrassing things you can ever do around me is if you have a beer, fine, if you have a smoke, but don't be you. If you've made that covenant, then claim that covenant. The covenant the Carter household has made is as for me and our house, hold, we're going to serve the Lord. We'll serve the Lord tomorrow. We'll serve the Lord when it's cold and windy like tomorrow afternoon. We'll serve the Lord when it's hot and dry like this summer. We're going to serve the Lord. And when somebody stumbles in the Carter household, we're going to be there and say, okay, do you want us to help pick you up? If fine, we will. If you're like, I got this, then we'll stand and watch you stagger around until you ask for help. Who are you going to serve? Jeremiah had his family turn against him, so he went to Daddy. You might be a household of one. Somebody might have betrayed you in that household, leaving you as a household of one. There's a God that says, in my household, I'll never forsake you. I'll never give up on you. Just obey my covenants. As we close this service, some of you might be feeling that little pain, that sting. I've grown up in a broken family. I've seen what brokenness in the family does to the family. It does create division. It does create sniping and biting and barking. A house divided cannot stand. A house united can. We are the family of God here. We are standing under the banner of Christianity. And when one of us stumbles, we will be there if a hand comes up to lift up. We will not be there to step on. I don't know about your home. If you want me to know about your home, you'll let me know about your home. But I challenge you to make that decision today. As for me and my household, there's a blank line there. I wonder what you're going to write in it. Would you stand with me, please? Father, speaking on this topic of family is painfully hard. For some might mistake that I'm the head of a perfect family. Father, I'll just be straight up right now. I am not the head of a perfect family, for I am not perfect. I pastor a church with broken people. I pastor a church with very, very good people. At a church there, struggling, stress-filled families. Families that are on the good road. So God, I just ask, as you being the Father over us, to speak to us. What are we going to write in that blank? As for me and my house, we're going to... I'll have that long pause there, Father, because I remember when I wasn't serving you. The family was a mess. So God, this morning, as your children rise to leave this your house and go out, the aisles are open. This altar is a pretty big altar, and it's wide open. I don't stand in front of it because there's no business doing it with me. But if somebody needs a prayer, Kim and I are down here absolutely to help them. Speak to your family, Father. Help us fill in that blank that says, as for me and my house, hold, we're going to serve you. I ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Right.
Gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you this day you've given us, Father God, and thank you for the message provided by Brother Steve today, Father God. Lord, I pray for our blood families and our church families, Father God, and that each of our families focus on you as the center of our family, and we look to you for guidance and direction, Father God, and we don't allow Satan to creep in and split us apart and break us apart, Father God. And Father, I just pray as we leave from here today that we go forward from here and we serve you, not just on Sunday, but on Monday through Saturday and 7 days a week, as we should, Father God. And Lord, as we go on this time of offering, I just pray that we generously give, Father, to further your kingdom, and that as we go forward from here, you keep us safe. Thank you, and I love you. In your great name I pray. Amen.
Stand up and grab a hand. Let's sing on out of here. We're going to sing the bridge of that first song we sang. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Sing it. it if you can with your honest heart.
Tame a life and let it be.